Good evening. Welcome to this is iBUG Buzz episode number 520. Welcome to the iBUG Buzz for Monday, February 7th, 2022. I am Maria and I will be facilitating the conference tonight along with Sandhya. This is an open forum for anyone with questions or issues with their iPhone, iPad, iPod Touch, Apple Watch, or Apple TV, and for anyone desiring to become more proficient in using the accessibility features of these iDevices. And we do focus on voiceover here. So welcome to everyone who has joined us in tonight live, and those who are listening to the conference via the recorded podcast playback. So yes, as you've heard, this meeting is being recorded. We kindly have a few rules that we ask everyone to follow to help keep the meeting running as smoothly as possible. First, we ask that everyone stay on mute when not speaking. We ask that also when you want to ask or answer a question that you unmute and then say your name and wait to be acknowledged by one of the facilitators. Again, that's myself, Maria, or Sandhya this evening. So we do not use the raise hand feature of Zoom on this call. Very important, please don't just speak out or make any kind of exclamations while others are speaking. If you want to announce yourself, wait till there's a break in the conversation. Speaking when others are speaking is very disruptive and distracting. And once you've asked your or answered a question, we ask that you kindly give others a chance to ask or answer questions so that everyone gets a chance to participate in the meeting. So just give others some chance before you ask your next one or make your next comment. Very important, we ask that you please minimize your background noise. So things like phones are ringing and people talking and TVs and clock chimes and stuff like that. If we have to tell you a couple of times, twice, that you have too much of that background noise, then we may have to remove you from the conference again to keep the quality of the call as high as possible. When it is time, the ways that you can mute and unmute yourselves in the Zoom app on an iPhone, the mute button toggles at the bottom left corner of the screen. In the on the iPad, that mute button on the app is at the top center of the screen. On Windows, on a PC, you're going to toggle with Alt-A, and on a Mac with Command-Shift-A. On the Mac and PC, you can use the space bar as a push to talk, meaning you press it and hold it, you talk, you're temporarily unmuted. While it's being held down, you release it and you're back to being muted. On a phone, if you're dialing in, you're going to toggle muting with *6 when it is time. So with that, I'm going to now turn it to Sandhya to tell you about some of the many, many things that we have going on.
Sandhya. All right. Thank you, Maria. So what do we have going on this week? Well, we have tomorrow on Clubhouse from 5 to 6. All times are going to be central. We're going to be doing the mini buzz. So a shorter version of what we're doing here tonight. So please come with any more questions. Maybe if they don't get all answered today, or you think of something in the middle of the night, bring them to us tomorrow. Then we have on Thursday, Vila Book Club. We are reading a very interesting book. It's called Sapiens, A Brief History of Humankind. It is by Yuval Harari, and it's DB 81,335. Definitely get started because it's almost 17 hours long. So I think we can make it. Maria, they can make it, right? If they start early.
Of course. Right? And you speed it up 3 times, you'll be done in less than 6 hours.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Okay. All right. Good. Good. She's the math person here. Okay. Then Friday, we have iBUG Night at the Virtual Movies. And for that big reveal, come back at, well, don't go away, but stay till 8, the midpoint of our call, and then we will have the clues and hope you'll participate and guess, and who knows, you might win one of those amazing prizes. Who knows what it'll be? All right, and then Saturday is iBUG Cafe. We have a great cafe set up this. We had to change it because of the Super Bowl. It's usually on the Sunday. Yes, you're right. You're not. Yes, Saturday from 4 to 6 p.m. Central Time here on the same Zoom conference line, we're going to be talking all about settings. So it is critical It is just going to help you use your phone and, you know, in a more efficient manner and maybe get rid of things that annoy you and, you know, all those kind of good things. So there's going to be a lot of good information jam-packed on Saturday at the iBUG Cafe led by Shree. Okay, and that is all my, oh, and then hold on real quick. Our website is ibugtoday.org, ibugtoday.org is the best place to get all the information. That's where you can register to get all your email notifications. Everything that we do is free, so there is no reason not to register and get on our mailing list. Facebook, we have facebook.com/group/iBugToday, great place to pose questions in between these various meetings. And there are always lots of great answers that you will get. So definitely check it out. We have a Twitter, very active Twitter at iBugToday. And then we have a mentoring program where if you are a beginner user and need help with your iPhone, then definitely fill out the application on our website and then we'll match you up with one of our amazing, amazing advanced users. And if you are an advanced user and would like to be a mentor to someone else and help them along learning the power of the iPhone, we welcome you as well. There's an application for you as well on the website. All right, Maria, those are our announcements for today.
All right, very good. Thank you, Sandhya. So with that, we're now going to go around and introduce ourselves, our names, and where we are from. So I am Maria in Albany, New York. And so feel free to unmute yourselves, as I've described earlier, to introduce yourselves.
This is Herbie in Houston.
Welcome.
Chanel in Houston.
Hello. This is Dan from Southern California.
Hello.
This is Terry from Arlington Heights,
welcome.
Illinois.
Yep, welcome. All right.
This is Dee from Southern Illinois.
Oh, see, there you go. That's nice. You worked that in, the both of you coming in at the same time from Illinois. Welcome. All right. Who else? This is
Kathy from Tulsa.
Welcome.
Emmy from Missouri.
Hello.
Jody from New Hampshire. Hi, Maria.
Hey.
Roy from Fort Worth.
Welcome.
Ned from Texas.
Hello.
Greg from Texas.
Welcome. And who else did I hear?
Sabrina from Texas.
Sabrina, welcome. All right. Anyone else?
Helene from Woodstock, but now Arizona.
All right. In warmer weather. Welcome. Right. Anyone else?
Steven from Austin.
Hi, Steven. And did I hear Susan, I think?
Arlene, North Carolina.
Oh, Arlene. Oh, welcome.
Thank you.
Linda from Texas.
Hello.
Sharon from New York.
Welcome.
Mo from Texas.
Hello. Right. Anyone else?
This is Sandhya from Houston.
Welcome.
Feeling outnumbered by you New Yorkers.
I know. We're slowly taking off. Who is that?
Jerry.
Jerry from Vermont.
Welcome.
How are you, Maria?
Hey, good. How are you?
Good.
Good. Anyone else? All right. Very good. Well, welcome to you all who would like to get us started this evening with a question or a comment.
This is Shree.
Go ahead, Shree.
Yeah, I just want to make one correction with what you said. That what we're going to cover at the cafe is the settings inside VoiceOver, not the settings, but settings inside the VoiceOver.
All right, very good. And in case anyone's thinking, believe me, yes, you can easily cover the whole cafe time with VoiceOver settings. So do join us for those. All right. Who'd like to ask the next question or make the next comment? Either or. All right. Has anyone any kind of new apps that you've played with or anything you've noticed after this. Well, it's been out for a little bit, but the iOS 15.3. Any comments on that?
Sharon?
All right, go ahead, Sharon.
I'm having a couple of weird things with the phone. And I wonder if everyone else is having it. The first is like for my texts, it's not making a sound when they come in, which is weird. And then today when I asked Siri to send a text and I said who I wanted it to go to, she sent it to someone else. And I know I have a strong accent, but the names were totally different. So I've never had anything happen like that before. And then the last weird thing was that over the weekend, a couple of times calls came in, but I never heard them. Like, you know, I'd end up getting a voice message, but I never heard the phone ring, and it wasn't on Do Not Disturb. So I don't know what's going on.
This is Herbie.
Okay, go ahead, Herbie.
So in regards to your second issue, when you say Siri sent it to the wrong person, like, did it tell you who it was sending it to? Like, did it say did it actually send it to the wrong person, or was it giving you the wrong name?
No, like I said, send it to, you know, I said send it to Roberta, and they sent it to David.
So hold on, I want to go back. So it did send it to David.
Yes.
Siri tell you, okay, sending, because usually Siri kind of, I think, does tell you who she's sending to.
Yeah, she didn't. I realized that later. You know, normally she says, or she'll say, ready to send it. And she just sort of sent it. So I don't know what was going on.
Okay. It's a little. It's not something I use often, but sometimes I will use that feature, like if I'm on AirPods and I'm not near the phone. So that's a little bit interesting.
Mm. Anyone else have any thoughts?
Hi, this is Sabrina.
Yep, go ahead, Sabrina.
It's funny that y'all mentioned it. I was going to ask a question similar to that. So I ended up having to replace my phone after like 2 days after I updated it to 15.2 and 15.3. I actually had to send my phone in to Verizon because it was having the similar issues.
Oh. Wow. Interesting. I wonder, my first thought, because I've sometimes had that happen where I don't hear the ringing sound. I wonder if it sounds like this is more than that, if it had to be sent back, but I wonder if a restart of the phone might help, you know, like the actual where you hold the power and volume buttons for a few seconds. And then in the dialogue, you do the slide to, you go to that double tap to power off. And you do that, and then, you know, you let it sit there for a bit, and then you hold the, you know, for, I don't know, like 10 seconds or so for it to be down. We'll take Herbie first, and then I think I heard you, Sabrina. So.
You know, one thing that I've noticed too, and I kind of, you guys mentioning it this, and I'd wonder at the time if I missed something, but I'm wondering if it's related, is I noticed like the other day, I'd been looking at my phone. I was surprised to see I had 4 missed text messages that I hadn't seen that were sent early in the day, and at the time I thought, well, maybe I just missed the notifications, but now I'm wondering if it's related to the issues that everybody else is having.
Mm-hmm. All right, go ahead, Sabrina.
So this is Sabrina. I did end up factory resetting my phone before I called to get a replacement, and I did talk to Apple as well. Shortly after they did 15.2 update, they immediately did a 15.3 update, and they said that there were some bugs in the 15.2 update and that I should update my phone to 15.3, and it's worked pretty well now that I updated it to 15.3. So if y'all don't have the 15.3 update, you might want to get that one because they sent it out like 2 days after the 15.2 update.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I think the big impetus for that was that Safari leaking people's data. They had to get that fixed. So, yeah. Well, that is good. So thank you for that. And, oh my goodness, I'm blanking on who actually asked this question. I'm so sorry, but
no problem.
Karen. Sharon, I'm so sorry. I should have, like, from New York as well. And I'm in New York State as well. How did I forget that? I'm sorry. Are you running 15.3 and still experienced?
I think I'm only at 15.1. So.
Ah, okay. Hmm. Well, there's
this Kathy. Possibly.
Go ahead, Kathy.
Sharon, are you using Verizon?
No, I'm actually using T-Mobile.
Because I have a friend in Tulsa who recently had switched phone services because it was dropping calls and calling the wrong people. And it was just something to do, don't quote me, but I guess it was something to do with Verizon and the G5 stuff, or they're switching the
G4
or something. I don't know.
Okay, go ahead, Herbie. Right. So, one sec. Sorry, Kathy, were you finished? I apologize.
I just gonna say one other thing, and this could be off the wall too, but check your volume. Like, my volume does weird things, and some could the volume on your phone ring and the volume on your little noise that you get when you get a message, could that be turned down for some reason?
All right. That is a good thought. Okay, go ahead, Herbie. I think you had...
Right, so this is... So a couple things. So first of all, Kathy, what you're talking about is 5G, not G5.
Whatever.
No. What if somebody comes out with... Never mind. Anyway, but in all seriousness. So what Sharon was experiencing was not a cellular provider issues. Like, it wasn't... Like, she wasn't dialing a number and it was calling something else. This was a Siri thing, and that goes through the internet and through your Wi-Fi or your cell provider for that matter, but that's still internet based, where Siri is the problem in this case, where it's sending to the wrong person for, because evil Siri, in my opinion, is evil, but we won't go there. So that would be more of an internet related issue. But what I was gonna say also too is, I think this is, you know, I think Braille users maybe have a good reason sometimes not to install updates, but
indeed,
really, in general though, as a general rule, you should always keep your phone up to date, because sometimes there are bug fixes within those updates that can affect the performance if you're on older software. So Sharon, in your case, I would definitely upgrade to iOS 15.3 tonight, or whenever, you know, just as soon as you can. So, and see if that resolves the issues that you are having or not. And that'd be the biggest thing. I think the most important thing you could do. And
otherwise, yeah. Very good. All right. Well, good luck with that, Sharon. Hopefully one of those will work for you, the updating or the, I think it make your phone restart anyway, which is good. And then checking the sound volume, but at least it sounds like you're not alone in this, unfortunately, it seems, so that it's something's going on. So hope that fixes it. But if not, I guess we'll just have to wait for 15.4. So,
Thanks, Kenny.
Go ahead, Kenny.
I have a comment I wanted to let people know. Those of you who have the KNFB reader app on your phone, they released an update and they changed the name to One Step Reader.
Yes, one step is a single word, right? Yep. That's how they're writing it, I think. Yeah.
So I just wanted to, in case people are looking for their KNFB reader, maybe they have automatic updates on, and that's what they've done.
This is Herbie with a question then.
On this same topic?
Yes.
Oh, okay. All right, go ahead.
So first of all, a comment and a question. First of all, I'm understanding now that it's actually no longer part. It's actually a separate company now that the NFB handed the KNFB reader over to. But
yes,
is it the number one and then step, or is it the word one?
Oh,
and
it's
then
the step? Word. It's the word O-N-E.
Okay. That's what I was unclear on.
So. Yeah. Sure. And the company is actually, I think it was this company like SensoTech, they had partnered, I think, with them initially. And okay. And now they just have completely handed it off to them. So.
Yeah, I'm just throwing that out there, and, you know, in case people still use Canon and they're looking for it. Oh, I don't see my Canon free reader.
And they did send, for those of you looking out, perhaps, I guess it's to all users. I don't know. I got some email about it. So, you might have something in your inbox, but that is good to know for those who do use that. So
this is great.
All right, I think Greg, you were first, and then we'll go to
can you just update through KNFB, or do you have to download the new app?
You would go, this is Kenny.
Go ahead, Kenny.
And update it through the App Store. This is strictly for the iOS, that I know of, the iOS version. Not sure about Android, but is definitely on the iOS version, iOS.
All right, thanks.
This is
Helene on the same.
Yep, go ahead, Helene.
I have KNFB Reader. My husband bought it for me. Years ago, and he died 3 years ago. And because he bought it and he died, he paid $99 for it. Mm-hmm. And during the pandemic, and I kept calling, and they, if I don't know Gene's password, but his phone doesn't exist, I've spoken to wherever it was out of Maryland. And they kept saying they felt badly, but I got so upset because they would never give me the access, even though it's the same last name and they know, and the credit card and all the same. Anyway, I finally bought SuperSense, which I struggle with. But can anyone tell me, is KNFB? And I also have Voice Dream Reader, and Jody taught me how to take a picture and read it. Is it worth hassling to get this one set?
All right. Anyone have any comments on the KNF or the one step? All right.
This is Kenny.
Go ahead, Kenny.
To answer your question, since you have Voice Stream Reader and SuperSense, and you can even get for free Seeing AI, I would honestly, if you so are so inclined, kind of save your money and not bother with it, because those three apps, they're very, they do very similar things, if not more. I hope that answers your question.
All right, I think someone else is going to comment on that too.
This is Dee.
Yep, go ahead, Dee.
Yeah, I was going to say, since I got Voice Dream Scanner, I never use my KNFB reader.
Okay.
I mean, I always used KNFB before that. I thought it was the hottest thing on earth, But man, when I got the Voice Dream Scanner, it's so much simpler and faster. I just don't think anything can beat it so far. And I would not purchase a $100 app again.
All right. And I think Herbie, yes, go ahead.
So, couple things.
Yes, and
meeting somebody.
Go ahead. Yes, I'm looking at who they are.
Everybody's muted. All right.
What I was going to say is, I also agree, first of all, with everybody that I don't think you really need KNFB Reader. I liked it better, more as an FTP scanner when I had some inaccessible PDFs, and now VoiceStream can even tackle those, so I don't think that you really need. If you are an NFB Newsline subscriber, the app does include a basic version of KNFB Reader, and I think it still does, even with the update. And the other thing I wanted to mention for Helene's predicament, if it was an App Store purchase, then Apple is not going to have access to, I'm sorry, not Apple, the NFB.
Oh, I'm so sorry. I got in a little late. Everyone, I just muted because of that background noise. So go ahead, Herbie, if you want to come back in.
That was my phone ringing. I was trying to take care of
it. Oh, okay.
Yeah, no, that was just my phone. Anyway, so now I don't know where I got cut off. I'm sorry.
You were just saying that if it was an App Store issue.
Oh, yes. So if he got it through the App Store, the NFB will not be able to help you, because they're not actually, it was an in-app purchase through Apple. It was made through Apple. And so you'd have to really talk to, I don't know how he purchased it, unfortunately, but that could be why they might not also be able to help you, but I don't think it's even worth the hassle of dealing with it or trying to purchase it yourself, because you know the other apps are so much more better than KNFB Reader was. So I don't even.
This is Helene.
Okay, go ahead, Helene.
I bought it through Gene's phone, and since that phone is dead and he is as well, there's nothing to do, because if I can't give them his, you know, getting back into the app store from his phone, which I can't do, it's sort of like, you know, I said, why can't you just do it under the circumstances? But it's, you know, it's a privacy issue.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it sounds like they can't, that they can't access, it's under like his Apple ID, but since that can't be accessed, right, sure. Well, it's sounding like, and I would concur with what others have said, I think I have not used that app for years now, probably, and I think, you know, you definitely do have, between the voice stream scanner and the super sense and such, and, you know, there's, as others have said with seeing AI, you definitely have, I think, much more, you know, modern apps and, you know, newer apps and simpler apps. Very good. All right.
This is Sri.
Go ahead, Sri.
I think, you know, what Helene just brought up is a great point about, you know, setting up legacy on the phone now. So that way, moving forward, you know, if something does, God forbid, happens to you, you can at least give some assurance that you're leaving some information about your device if someone else in your family that you give access to can get that information.
How do you do that again?
This is Sri.
Yeah, Sri, do you want to explain? Yep.
I don't have my phone in front of me, but if you go to, I think it's under settings under your name, and you swipe right till you get to legacy contact. You double tap on that, it's going to ask you to go through some questions about, you know, who you're going to assign the legacy to. I am skipping some steps here, but eventually what you'll get is either a text or a QR code that will be sent to the person that you're giving access to in the event that something happens. And then you can go to Apple, and I think you're going to have to provide a death certificate as well as the QR code, and then they'll give you permission to access your device. Or access that person's device, sorry. That's like a high level summary there, sorry.
Yeah, no, that's good. So hopefully that is, I know, unfortunately, Helene, I can't help you right now, but in terms of hopefully that helps someone on the call to hopefully, you know, be able to have a little more control over what happens to their phones. So thanks for bringing, I actually wasn't even aware of that feature. So thank you for mentioning that. Very good. All right. Who would like to ask the next question?
This is Roy.
Go ahead, Roy.
I wanted to go back to Sharon's issue with missing calls and stuff. If you go to settings, to sounds and haptics, there is a volume control in there for ringers and alerts. Sharon, you might want to go there and make sure your volume's up at 100%. Sometimes it'll lower itself for no reason.
All right.
That's all I had. I just thought that might be worth sharing.
Sure. All right. Very good. All right. Anyone else with a new question or comment?
This is Sri.
Okay, go ahead, Sri.
I just want to make a correction from my last week. I made a comment about someone, I think it was Karen, who asked about making a phone call, excuse me, to a third call. And I mentioned you could do that when you go to contacts and open up the virtual keyboard. I was incorrect when I said that. There's actually a keypad on the toolbar that you can get to make a secondary call. So I just wanted to make that correction.
All right. Very good.
This is Jerry from Vermont. Can you hear me?
Yep, go ahead, Jerry.
Okay, good. All right, because I'm having trouble. My Bluetooth device isn't muting and unmuting properly. Tonight, so I got to walk over to the phone.
No, it's not just you with the muting and unmuting tonight. Trust me. So I don't know what's happening. Okay. But yes, we can hear you.
I just wanted to say that I don't know about the legacy thing. I haven't seen that. But what I have seen is recover contacts that it's probably different than the legacy setting. We were talking about legacy, and if someone, you know, can't recover their phone for whatever reason, or if you can't recover your phone, you can, that other person can recover your phone because they've gotten that text with the Apple ID and what you have to do to recover it. I believe that's the title of it. Correct me, of course, if I'm wrong, but I think that may be different than the legacy setting, but does anyone want to comment on that?
All right. Does anyone, is this ringing bells for anyone? You think it's called recovery contact or recovered?
This is Shree.
Okay, go ahead, Shree.
Yeah, there's two of those. There is the recovery and there is the legacy. They're two different, they have two different purposes. I believe the recovery is, you know, for you to get access to the account, but the legacy is like, you're giving permission through Apple to give permission to give access to a device. And there's some limitations on what permissions you can get from Apple, but those two, there's two settings, and they may have been with 15.2, those come available where you can get those two options, but they're two separate options.
All right. Very good. Thank you for that. So yes, things for us to explore for sure. All right. Very good. Who would like to make the next comment or ask the next question?
Alisa?
All right, go on, Alisa.
Hi.
Oh, dear. Okay, you cut out. So can you start over?
Yes, Alisa.
Yep, I heard you, but then I didn't actually hear what you were saying.
So I was on the phone with Apple tech support on Saturday for like the whole entire morning and half of the afternoon.
Goodness.
And I was wondering, because they mentioned that my battery was integrated, I believe, if that's the right term.
Okay, so you're wanting to know
what does that mean when this says your battery is integrated?
That it's integrated? Is that the term that you're saying?
I think so. I think Shree, you see my post.
This is Herbie.
Okay, go ahead, Herbie.
Are you sure they didn't say your battery is degrading?
No, it says integrated.
Hmm.
Even when I looked on the live and battery thingy where it has the battery issue, the battery life power and stuff, because I did, they did an Apple, they did like a test or something on it, I think.
Mm-hmm.
Not sure what kind of test. They did a diagnostics testing.
Okay, yeah. So are you saying like when you checked your battery life, the battery capacity, that it still seemed okay?
Well, it said I needed a new battery, and I don't know.
Oh, it did.
Cost.
Okay. So I think so. Like right. So the term. So maybe what they were trying to say, because the battery in the iPhones isn't. Oh, sorry. Yeah, it's not user replaceable. So maybe that's what they were trying to tell you, that because it's integrated, that you have to, like, it's in, you cannot as a user replace the battery. So maybe they were trying to say that you had to take it in, like, to an Apple store or send it to Apple to have them.
That I could take it into a Best Buy, I think, or an Apple store. I'm sorry.
Oh, okay. Yeah, that's
fine. I didn't mean to cut you off.
Sure. Yeah, I mean, it sounds like you're going to have to take it somewhere if it's, you know, telling you you need a new battery, because you can't just like order a new one, you know, new battery and put it in.
This is Marty.
Take it to Best Buy.
Oh. Okay. Can you take it to, okay, go ahead, Marty, and then we'll.
Yeah. Alisa, there's a battery health button, and that will tell you your battery capacity, whether it's 80%, but also Batteries Plus, if you have one of those stores, they will replace your battery for you, because I think Apple charges for a new one. They have promotions from time to time, but normally it's about $60 for a new battery. Which iPhone do you have?
Elise, are you? You might be muted. I'm not.
Elisa, yes.
There you are. Okay. Yep. Go ahead. Your iPhone.
I have an iPhone 8, and that's what they diagnosed it with when we did the diagnosed test on Saturday.
Okay. So your question is that you're wondering if you can take it to Best Buy to have the batteries replaced?
Or where's a good place to take it besides
Best Buy? This is Marty.
I see. Okay, Marty, go ahead.
Like I said, Batteries Plus, if you have one of those stores, I think it's Batteries Plus Bulbs or something like that. And they have batteries for everything, car batteries and batteries for all. And I think they can replace your battery. Okay. A technician has to do it. Yeah.
This is sure. Sherry.
Okay, go ahead.
Sherry.
Okay. I think I heard Terry first and then Sherry. Go ahead, Terry.
Yes, you can take it. Usually you can take it to Best Buy. It used to be that you had to take it to an Apple certified place. It wouldn't necessarily have to be an Apple store, but it had to be Apple certified. And I think now they've relaxed some of that because of, I think they got sued or something for some of that. They weren't just allowing batteries to be replaced. But anyway, so I believe you can take your phone to Best Buy. What you could do is call and ask first, just to save you a trip there, and they would be able to tell you, but I believe you can. Batteries Plus, yes, you can if you have one nearby, but you know, and it's a good place too. Those are two good places to go. We have a store here called ABT that also replaces battery, and there it's an Apple certified repair place too. And so that's what you really, you know, want is some place that definitely knows how to replace those batteries.
All right. And Shri, go ahead.
I think, you know, mostly everything that you guys said was what I was saying. I think the reason they say integrate is that you and the average person can't access that battery, and they're saying it's integrated. So yeah, I think that's, it's just a term to make us sound nervous, but it's basically just need to get your battery replaced.
This is Marty.
Okay, go ahead, Marty.
Yeah, one more suggestion, Lisa, that I just thought. If you don't want to go that route, you can buy a battery case. So it's a case, and it will make your phone a little bit heavier and a little bit bigger, but they're like 5,000 or 6,000 milliamps, and you just push the button on the back of the case, and it will charge your phone battery at least one time or two times, and you can, you know, have better battery life that way too. And they're about between $20 and $30. Amazon has a lot of them.
This is Herbie.
All right, very all right, Herbie, we'll take your comment and then we'll shift from this.
So I think part of the problem, Elisa, you're concerned with this because like where you're at, there's not too many things in your immediate area in terms of Best Buys or whatever. Is that correct?
All right. I'm thinking, Elisa, you might be muted.
Elisa?
There you are.
Yes.
Yep, go ahead.
Can you repeat your question again, Herbie?
So is a concern, like, are there any, all right, because I know where you're at. So, like, are there any Best Buys or whatever in Porter? Because I don't know if there actually are.
I mean, I know there's Best Buys in Umbo, and then the closest Apple store is the Woodlands, but I don't really right. go to the Woodlands. That's the problem.
Yeah, because where you're at, you may have to find one of those I'm sure there are battery replacement dealers in Porter, but
because I know there's a Best Buy in Campbell.
Right.
I think.
You just given like your location, you know, unless if it's too much of a hassle to get to a Best Buy or an
Apple store. I can get to one. I know where that is.
Then yeah, I would definitely try to get to go to one if you can. So yeah. Otherwise, I was going to say Shree's option might be the best bet if you can't get. That's all I was going to say. Go ahead.
Yeah, Dina. I do have. Okay. I think Linda had a comment.
Okay, very good. All right, let's see. I think I thought I heard Dana first and then Linda. So go ahead, Dana. I'm sorry, were you? I apologize if I, but and I apologize, Linda, if I misheard that, but I didn't catch. So Dana, go ahead.
You can let her go first. But I was going to just make the comment that make sure that if you go to Best Buy, they if you don't have Apple Care, then they won't touch your phone. Make sure that they don't require you to have Apple Care, because that happened to me. I took my phone there and they said, do you have Apple Care? I said, nope. They said, well, good luck, find somewhere else.
Oh, wow. All right. And then Linda, go ahead.
Yes, Lisa, I believe there's a kiosk in the Deerbrook Mall that replaces the batteries.
All right. Well, good luck. Hopefully, Lisa, one of those will work out for you. Because, yeah, that is, or even the case or something. Because, yeah, it is, these batteries, they go quickly with how much we use our phones, for sure.
This is Elisa.
All right. And we'll have you have the last word on this one. Go ahead.
Jeez, I was getting nervous. I was like, oh my God, I was so nervous. I was like, sure, Lord, I mean, I gotta get a new phone.
No, the batteries, yeah, they can be replaced.
I was like shaking. People, I was like, oh,
this is Sandhya.
Well, okay, go ahead, Sandhya.
Oh, sorry, I had a follow-up for Helene's question about the legacy and so forth. So that is under, like we said, under settings, and then write what your name is, and then after you double tap on your name, there are several things under there, and one of them is passwords and security, and then it's the second thing under there. So once you hit that, then you'll find account recovery and legacy. So
very good. Well, thank you for that. Excellent. So I'm sure, I know I learned something with that. I was too caught up with the Braille issues to actually pay attention to what was new in this version. So thank you. All right. Very good. Who would like to give us our next discussion topic? All right, go ahead, Troy.
I have another question about this external battery thing. I have a SE2020 and I've managed to waller out the power plug so that when I try and plug it in, it just doesn't see it. It doesn't connect very well. Can I use that external battery and just bypass this port on my phone and charge the battery and just hook it up to my phone?
All right. Who would like to answer that? Who has some experience with battery cases?
This is Marty.
All right, go ahead, Marty.
Roy, are you talking about a battery case or a power bank? Because well, I can tell you if you ruined your plug, a battery case will not work because the battery case is plugged into the port. I think your only solution is like a power bank that you'll have to just kind of drag along with you. And they come in all kinds of capacities.
This is Terry.
Go ahead, Terry.
I have a battery. It's called a sticky battery that fits on the back of my phone, which is a iPhone SE 2020. And it's got its own separate USB-C port. So I can plug a USB-C cable into it and it will charge the battery, the phone just fine.
All right. So just to clarify, you're not needing to use the Lightning port on your SE 2020. All right.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
This is Roy.
Good. All right. Go ahead, Roy.
Would you say that again? What's that called?
It's called a sticky battery. In fact, I mentioned it. I don't know if that's up yet I can go look up the precise name. I bought it from AMAZON. I don't want to say the name in case somebody's Alexa devices or
the A lady,
whatever. This is A lady devices. But
this is Marty.
Okay. All right. Go ahead, Marty.
Terry, I think the one you're talking about is the one you talked about on the Apple workshop. That's the iWalk 5,000 milliamp battery thing. It's like the sticky. It's iWalk. I think iWALK.
Perfect. Thank
okay.
You.
Terry, is that sounding like it or is that a different?
I think so. I'm okay. going to go double check just Very to be good. Sure, but I think Marty's might be correct.
All mm-hmm. right. Very good. You got that, Roy? iWalk 5000.
This is true. Thank you.
Wonderful. Go ahead, Sri.
I just want to get some clarification. I'm a little confused here. So either it's going to snap in back of your phone or it's going to be a case or it's going to need that lightning port either to tether it or how is the sticky thing charging that is connecting to your phone?
This is Terry.
Yep, go ahead, Terry. Yep.
I don't know how it does it, but I can tell you that it does it. It's got an adhesive on this battery. And I have it stuck. In fact, I could either put it right on the phone or in my case, I do actually have a case. My phone in a case, not a battery case, but just a protective case that fits over the back and the sides of the phone. And the sticky battery fits to it. And honest to goodness, I can plug a USB-C cable into the USB-C port on the sticky battery and it charges the phone. This charges the battery and the phone itself.
All right, go ahead, Sri.
So basically, you're getting a G charging, it's basically wireless G charging your phone.
Right.
Okay, that makes sense. Thank you.
Yeah, interesting. Mm-hmm. Either that, do you think is it that or MagSafe or something? Not, is it one of those? Three. Go ahead, Sri.
It's not MagSafe, it's G charging because the SE doesn't support MagSafe. So it's just.
Support that, just, right.
It's just okay. G-charging the, because okay. I think the SC has a glass back, is what I'm being told. So it's mm-hmm. probably G-charging.
All right. Go ahead, Elisa.
I had a question for Terry.
Oh, okay. On this battery case?
Yes.
Okay. Go ahead.
So Terry, how many, for those of you who use it, how many times does it get unsticky? Or how do you know if it's going to get unsticky? Or how do you know if it's done charging your phone?
When if I fully charge the sticky battery, it will charge my phone at least two times. At least. And what happens, actually, I guess I want to say three times because it first runs the battery down. And then when it gets, it charges the battery and it's at, like 100% for a couple of days. And then once the battery charge starts going down, then I know it's the battery that's now being powered. But once you have the sticky battery fully charged, I don't have to recharge my phone for several days. And I use my phone a lot.
Very good. Well, it sounds like that could be a solution to both of you. All right. Very good. Well, thank you for that. So good discussion and a little Xavier. Eye toy. All right. Who was that, Dana?
Xavier.
Oh, Xavier. So sorry. Go ahead.
Hi. I'm having a problem with my voiceover. It goes in and out and sometimes I can't get it back to come on. And even on this call, I'm trying to go to different settings like the unmute button and I barely can hear it. What do I have to do?
All right. Anyone have any tips on getting voiceover speech to be more audible on a meeting.
This is Dan.
Go ahead, Dan.
It could possibly be, I've noticed on Zoom, a lot of times the volume for voiceover gets lowered because you're in Zoom. So you just may have to just increase the volume. We hit the volume button and bring it up.
Brad?
All right, go ahead, Brad.
You might want to check in your router and see what the volume of voiceover is relative to your system volume. I don't have I usually have mine set at like 85% under normal usage, but when I'm on a Zoom call, I may need to raise or lower it depending upon what's going on the Zoom call. And do I want to hear voiceover speech, you know, louder, or do I want to hear a little softer in the background? So I think that if you adjust the volume on the side buttons, you're just adjusting the system volume, and that's going to make Zoom louder as well as voiceover. And I don't see that accomplishes anything, but check the voiceover volume relative to the system volume may help you out.
This is Terry.
Okay, go ahead, Terry.
There are times when all of a sudden my voiceover volume will decrease when I'm on Zoom. And so what I do is triple click the home button to turn voiceover off, which is different than turning off the speech, but I'll turn voiceover off and then I triple click it again because I have my phone set to do that, and turn voiceover back on. And usually that fixes the problem if it ends up being that it suddenly is not as loud as it normally is on Zoom.
Xavier?
Go ahead, Xavier.
What the main problem is, sometimes my voiceover just goes out, not even on Zoom call. I just can't get it to work. I can't hear anything. I try to triple tap, double tap, yeah, and then to try to turn speech on, speech off, triple tap the side button, and sometimes I don't know, I could do it 10 times and 11 times it'll work out of nowhere. So I don't, it just goes in and out.
This is Sri.
Terry.
Okay, I think I heard Sri first.
So Xavier, I completely agree with what you experienced, because I experienced it too, and I have no idea why why voiceover just stopped. I could not get it back till I rebooted it, and I tried basically everything that people just suggested and it didn't work. So I don't know if it's a quirkiness, if something happened that caused voiceover to get hung up, but I can tell you I've experienced it.
Okay, go ahead, Terry.
As have I, and I've been told that it's a bug, and it's been here for quite a while. For
Dana.
A good part of iOS 14 for me.
You mean 15? Or no, even I back to 14?
Oh, 14. I haven't updated this phone to 15 because of all the issues there. So I've just chosen not to.
Sure. Okay. So wow, it's been even since 14. Okay, yep. Go ahead, Dana.
Yeah, I was just gonna say the same thing happened to me. It has happened to me. And what I had to do, I was just experimenting. I put wired earbuds in and held the up volume button in while I ran my finger all over the screen. And that made the volume go up in the earphones, or the earbuds, I mean. And then I took the earbuds out and it seemed to be okay.
Wow. All right. Anyone else have any thoughts? All right. Well, maybe Xavier, that's another thing to try with earbuds. Okay. Yeah, I've experienced this too. It's definitely not as stable as it could be, for sure. Oh, either on the speech or the braille side. All right. Well, good luck with that for sure. All right. Anyone else like to ask? We have 5 more minutes before the halftime show. We can sneak in another question or comment.
This is Sri. I've got a question.
Okay, go on, Sri.
So I was wondering if anyone has experience where when you're in the mail app and you're swiping right through the list of your messages, I've noticed that sometimes, you know, when it automatically reads the next message. And now I'm noticing that more frequently, it doesn't automatically go to the next message.
So what happened? Go ahead.
Like when this is when I'm like deleting a message. Like I would delete a message, it would jump to the next message below it.
Mm-hmm.
And then I delete it, it'll go jump automatically to the next message. Now I'm noticing that once I delete, it just stops. Like I have to go ahead and swipe right to go to the next message. And, you know, I'm not actually opening it. I'm just kind of, you know, swiping right, listening, not interested, delete. It typically goes to the next message. But now I'm having to swipe right to go to the next message after I do a deletion.
Mm-hmm. And this is in the list of messages, right? Like in a folder? Mm-hmm. Okay.
No, just like your inbox email.
Uh-huh.
You just do all your inbox messages, you know, like my morning email look and, you know, this is junk. Oh, delete. It just go to the next message, starts reading. And I would say delete. You know, and when I delete, you know, swipe up. So I hear delete, double tap, just automatically goes to the next message on the list.
Right.
Now I'm noticing that this stops.
Uh-huh. All right. Anyone else have experience? Go ahead, Dan.
I've noticed the same thing. It's sometimes it'll automatically go to the next message, and then sometimes it'll just jump to the top, and I'll have to just swipe all the way down and find the next message. So basically, I'm noticing the same thing.
All right. Well, again, this sounds like we hope that this is fixed in, I know the iOS 15.4 is on its way. So hopefully some of this stuff will get fixed in this upcoming update. Okay, go ahead, Kathy.
Sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt.
No,
Sometimes I think it moves better if you're in the message and you use delete at the bottom instead of going down the list.
You mean like if he opens the message?
Mm-hmm. Right. And then just hit delete along the bottom. You just hit delete and it'll go to the next message, I think.
Okay.
I don't know.
Sure. Well, there's something to try and see what happens. All right. Any other thoughts on this one? All right. Well, I think we do have enough time for another question before the halftime show. Is everyone just ready for the halftime show?
We want to know.
This is Sri.
Okay, go ahead, Sri.
Just want to wish you a happy belated birthday.
Thank you.
I have one quick question, Xavier.
All right, go ahead, Xavier.
Yeah, if you, when I double tap my side button twice, shouldn't that activate Siri? Or if I have it on, just hey Siri, does it have to be either or can you have both?
All right.
This is Jerry from Vermont.
Oh. All right. I wasn't sure who that was before you. All right, go ahead, Jerry. We'll take you.
All right. I'll just be quick. You actually don't double tap the side button for Siri. You hold it in. And yes, you can do both. I have my my Hey Siri on as well. And you can do both. Yeah.
So do you hold it and talk or you hold it and let it go?
You hold it in and it'll go beep, beep, you know, and then you talk and then you let it go.
Gotcha.
That's not my experience anyways. Yeah. Yeah.
This can't be
good. Very good.
Yeah, Maria, this was just Dana. It was
yes,
me,
Dana.
But
sorry. Go ahead if you want to make a comment.
It's okay. I was going to say the same thing. So.
Okay. All right. Well, apologies and thank you for
No, it's all right.
Thanks for understanding. All right, sure. Let's see, Kathy, let's see. I think we might actually be coming up here to the halftime. So if you mind, I'm going to turn it to Sandhya, and then we can take your question after the half to the movie and the iBug bite if you want to bring it up again at that point. So Sandhya.
Okay. All right. Thank you, Maria. My goodness. Lots of questions and information. Okay. So now we're getting ready for our midpoint. So if you came in and didn't get to say hello the first time around, please say who you are and where you're from, if you'd like to be sociable. If not.
This is Brad. I'm in Dallas.
Hey, Brad. Welcome.
Shelby in Baytown.
Shelby, welcome.
Dana in Ohio.
Dana, welcome.
David in Houston.
David. Anybody else?
Kelsey from Ohio.
Hey, Kelsey, welcome.
Thank you.
Carol from Houston.
Hey, Carol, welcome.
Hey.
All right, anybody else?
Elisa in Porter.
All right, welcome, Elisa.
Nikki in San Francisco.
Hey. Welcome, welcome.
Thank you.
Xavier, Atlanta.
Hey, Xavier, welcome. Anybody else? All right. Okay, well, with that, we are going to now talk about the iBUG night at the virtual movies and with those inscrutable clues. I'm just running out of adjectives. We're going to hand it over to, dare I say it? Well, the iBUG guy, or AKA the love revolutionary. I can't believe I just said that.
You actually went there.
I know.
Oh my gosh.
Oh my God.
The love revolutionary. Yes, yes, yes.
Oh,
welcome, everyone. Oh no, you're welcoming me. I keep messing up. Okay. Yes, we are ready for the big reveal of the virtual night at the movies. All right. Let's see. We are going to do just like we always do. Say your name, wait to be recognized before you shout out the title for our Michael movie.
Wow. You could take up yodeling pretty soon. Pretty good.
All right. All right. Let's see. We've got a great set of clues here. Where's my assistant? Pull up those clues for me. oh, wait, I need some water.
Oh my goodness, come on.
Okay, here we go. Clue number one. This week's film is set in a city we have seen many times before.
This is Shree.
Shree.
Please don't say it's Richmond.
No, that's not it.
Shree thinks the whole world revolves around Richmond. Okay, keep going. Anybody else?
Any other guesses for our NYC film setting?
Repeat the clue. Elisa, can you repeat? What? Elisa, can you please repeat the clue?
This week's film is set in a city we have seen many times before. NYC.
Elisa, New York?
What?
He's just giving you the city, but okay. Anybody guesses on that movie or we're moving on?
Guesses on the movie.
Jody? I don't know. I give up.
Jody.
Made in Manhattan.
Made in Manhattan would be a good guess.
You keep guessing that, Jody, one day. But
I like that movie.
I can tell.
You remember that, Claudia. Yes, I remember coming up with that one.
Okay, Dana.
Blind Love.
Blind Love. Never heard of it. So it can't be it.
This is Kenny.
Kenny.
No, don't say it. Don't say it, Kenny.
Sleepless in Seattle.
Oh, Kenny got a good guess, but unfortunately. All right.
Well, at least you didn't say Frozen.
Okay. Number two. Oh, okay. The film is an adaptation of the Broadway play The Front Page.
That's the name of the Broadway play?
Yes.
This is strange.
Three.
Bronx Tale?
Bronx Town. Maybe.
No, Tale.
What?
Bronx Tale. Bronx
Hog's Tale. No.
Hog's Tale. Okay. That's not even close.
Obviously, he's never heard of that either.
Anybody else that hasn't had a turn? Come on, y'all.
Adaptation of the Broadway play, The Front Page.
This is Sabrina.
Sabrina.
Is it the Doozies?
Say that again?
Is it the movie called Newsies?
Newsies. No,
that's...
That's a good guess, but that's not it either.
Hey, good for trying, though. Okay. Anybody else?
All right, moving on to clue number three.
Good, good, good.
It is a newsroom drama, a crime story, and a romantic comedy.
Oh, boy. Is it a rom-com?
It's all rolled into one. Shree.
Is it Broadcast News?
Broadcast News. I've actually seen that one. But that's not it either.
Brad's whispering. Brad, what are you saying?
I said it was a Swiss. He said whatever the clue was, it was three things. I said it was a Swiss Army knife of movies.
That's a good analogy.
Like a Sabrina's got it. Go, Sabrina.
The newsroom?
Newsroom! Oh, Sabrina, that is so close, but that's not it either.
She's trying. Anybody else? All right.
All right, moving on to clue number four.
Four already? Oh, okay.
We see the newspaper editor will do anything to keep his star reporter from moving to Albany with a goofy insurance salesman.
This is Jerry from Vermont. Network, is it Network?
Network, that is another movie that I've seen. Yes, yes. But not the one we're showing this week.
Oh, come on. Okay. The
editor will do anything to keep his star reporter from moving to next door to Maria.
And she still doesn't know the movie, even with that clue.
All right. Next and final clue. Fifth clue.
Yeah, that's
the first. The first film adaptation. Actually, there was a first film adaptation of the play, The Front Page, was produced by that eccentric aviator, Howard Hughes.
This is Shree.
Shree.
Is it The Aviator?
The Aviator is not even close. All right. Unless you're like 80 years, you were around 80 years ago, you didn't get to see this when it first played. Our film this week is called His Girl Friday, starring Cary Grant and Rosalind Russell.
Never heard of it.
Never heard of it.
We know that.
Yeah,
we
can tell.
We've heard of it.
This is Ned. Pocket details, Sandhya.
There's Ned. What?
Darn
Ned?
It! I should have said it. I was going to say His Girl Friday, but
I'm sure.
Didn't.
I'm so sure. Ned.
I know.
Woulda, coulda, shoulda, but
I know.
We'll give Ned the shoulda, woulda, coulda.
Yeah. Tried. Darn it.
Ned. Too late. Scratch that.
This okay. is scary. Remember, you got to give the prize from last week because nobody got it.
No, nobody got this one either. So
darn
it's a tough world out there.
Times are tough. Right.
Supply chains are big problems right now.
Things are stacking up.
All right. So
rent a new warehouse for our prizes.
I know. And it was a good prize, but sorry.
The film stars Cary Grant and Rosalind Russell.
Yes, that's right. See, now he knows.
I'm just having to rent warehouse space for all these unclaimed prizes.
The train
virtual
is taking up a
prizes.
Lot of room. Thank
all
you,
right. Miss. Love Revolutionary has to sign out now.
Oh, what a tragedy.
Is that a threat or a promise?
This is the dawning of the age of Aquarius. I shouldn't have said it. No, we've started this. Okay. Thank you, Ms. McGulloch. Now we're going to start our next part of our program is the iBUG Bites, where we help with provide information on a helpful hint or clue for you. Hey, see how poetic that is? And then that'll be a very brief demo. And then after that, we will resume with our questions. So keep the questions coming, be thinking. But first, listen to this message from Maria. Hold on.
All right.
Okay, well, everybody's muted. Maria, you got to come back in.
Okay. My braille display didn't, I didn't refresh, so I thought I was muted. Okay, thanks. All right. So I'm going to be talking about a simple little tip, but hopefully a helpful tip. And that is how, you know, on your, for those who use the PC, if you really, really need to go to a website super frequently and you don't want to open your browser and go to your bookmarks or you don't want to search it through the start menu or what have you, you can set up a shortcut to a web page on your desktop and just launch it with one keystroke, basically. Or you can kind of do something similar in iOS, and that is to add a page to your home screen. And so why would you want to do this? First of all, as I said, there might be this page that you have to access often. Maybe it changes a lot and you just need to access it in a pinch. And you don't even want to just like open Safari and go to your favorites and, you know, click on it, or go to your history, your bookmarks, what have you, and or Spotlight search. And this is a quick way to do it. So I have this set up and I'm going to show it here. I deleted it so I can show it. I have this set up. I've added to my home screen the website, which shows the bus schedule for the route that I take to work. And why I do this, you might wonder. There's an app. Well, that app, once I navigate over to this schedule, it literally takes me to this exact same page. And, you know, often I'm standing there at the bus and now it's cold and I just want to find out when my bus is supposed to be arriving, and I want to minimize the amount of tapping I have to do in the cold. And so now with this homepage shortcut, all I have to do is unlock my phone and then double tap on one icon, and there I am. So how to do this, and you might have your own scenarios, but just wanted to put that in as an intro. So how we do this, so I am here on this page.
Skip close, make top, heading level one.
That's CDTA.
Banner, landmark.
Which text speech mispronounces, but it's CDTA. And if I go flick down, my rotor set to headings.
Logo. Head New Scotland, real time New Scotland Avenue. Real time arrivals for February.
As you can tell, it was saying real time arrivals for this date. So I am on the schedule page. I've navigated to it. So
toolbar, share button.
So to add this to the
actions available
to the home page. It's quite simple. We're going to go to the share sheet, which is on that bottom toolbar of Safari, where you have your back and forward and share and show bookmarks and tabs. So we're going to pick share, which is in the middle. And then we're going to
toolbar, share, root 13, ta.org. Heading.
And this is your typical share sheet.
Actions available.
And so now what we're going to look for is the relevant item. It's sort of like in the middle. I was trying to see whether going from the top or bottom would be quicker. And it also depends on what apps you have and such, which can share. And really, it didn't make too much of a difference in my case. So I'm just going to use a quick combo of scrolling and flicking to quickly reach it here.
Kim, the
we're just
LinkedIn, Kindle, more, copy.
So we passed a bunch of messaging contacts and some third-party apps, and now we're getting to some native iOS actions, which everyone sees, like this copy.
Add bookmark button.
This is to add the actual bookmark traditionally as you would in Safari under bookmarks, but
add to favorites
button. And similarly to the favorites bar in Safari.
Find on page button, add to home screen button.
And so there we have, so you saw the typical find on page, and then we had this add to home screen. And if you go too far, by the way,
add to reading list,
you get to add to the reading list. So it is between these two. It's this whole section of adding it to different things. And most of them are in Safari, but if we go to add to home screen,
add to home screen button,
and we double tap,
add text field is editing.
And VoiceOver did not tell us where we were. It just said nothing. So what I did there was flick left and right to get to where I needed to be, or to actually find out where I was. I'm sorry. And this is an edit field. So a screen has opened up. So if we move to the top of the screen,
cancel button.
We have the cancel button in the upper right hand corner, and we flick to the right.
Add to home screen heading.
This heading.
Add button.
And an add button in the upper right, because we could just add it here. However, I would say not to do that, because if we flick to the right again,
text field is editing my app character mode. Insertion pointed end.
It has this very generic name of my app, which is not, I imagine, what you want to call this. And by the way, what else is in here?
Clear text button. https://. An icon will be added to your home screen so you can quickly access this website. App.
And there we go. And that's a prediction for how it said my app. But you can tell there on the screen is also the URL and that little explanation from Apple. So I'm just going to quickly, I'm going to clear the text, and I'm going to type in
text field
very quickly using my Braille display so as not to take time here. So I have now typed in
text field is editing root 13 schedule. Character mode, insertion pointed.
Very much more useful, yeah, than the generic my app title. So we're going to go to the add button in the upper right-hand add corner.
Button. Doc. Safari.
And don't you love it? I should have been focused on this shortcut, but I wasn't. That's okay. We're going to go on my home screen here.
Route 13 schedule.
And I know where it got added, so I just touched there, but it's going to get added basically in the next open spot. As you can tell here, this is the Route 13 schedule icon. So let me, I'm going to close this out in Safari to prove to you that this works. I'm going to completely close out Safari. Okay. So here we go. I'm closing Safari. I've closed all the tabs in Safari.
And we're
back to the home page, home screen with this Route 13 schedule shortcut that we added. And if I double tap, it's loading. And we're not being told anything, but if I touch near the center of the screen,
link, image, trip direction, link, Slingerlands to downtown Albany.
Aha.
Link,
and so I know.
List and
I know based on that this is now setting the direction to show me the bus schedule. So just with the one, double tap of that icon, I've gotten to this page. And so just to show you, this is an actual book. This is an actual just a bookmark that's added here, which I can show you by way of if I wanted to delete it, if I go into edit mode.
Edit back, edit mode, started editing.
So that's flicking down to edit with the actions rotor and then double tapping. And so then if I go to either activate or delete in this case.
Stop editing at delete, drag, activate, default.
Because the default action here will be to delete it. You can't just rename it in the native support from here. But so if I either activate or then go to delete and double tap.
Alert, delete bookmark. Are you sure you want to delete the bookmark Route 13 schedule? Cancel, delete.
So I just flicked to the right there repeatedly so you can see the dialogue. And so you see there, it did refer to it as a bookmark. So it literally is just adding a bookmark, but in a bit more of a convenient spot that is in theory quicker to get to. So you can use this, you know, for anything where you really need or want to access the site, you know, or a specific page of a website in a pinch. And thought I would share it because I just recently I'm using it here myself with the schedule. So hope you find it helpful. It's very simple and could be useful. So if anyone has any questions, I'm happy to take them, but hopefully it's a pretty simple process. Oh, yep. Go ahead, Terry.
Can you clarify at the beginning, you open the web page, the website, and you went to that web page? I'm not sure what you
yes
did to begin with.
Yes. Okay. Yes. So thank you. I figured I was like, oh, I don't need to spend your time, you know, navigating over to this page. But yes. So I opened Safari, and then yes, I did what I normally do to go to that site. Like I went to cdta.org and I clicked on schedules, and then I clicked on Route 13, and then that was the page that was loaded in my Safari when I started my demo. So I literally navigated to the page as if I were just visiting it. And then because the share sheet applies to the current page. So I had to navigate to the page I wanted to add as my shortcut. And then I you know, went to the add to home screen from there. So yes, I navigated to the specific page.
So the specific page, and then share, and
yep,
then add to.
Exactly.
Got it. Thanks.
Yep. Good question.
This is Greg.
Go ahead, Greg.
So that's really a neat feature. Can you have an icon on your homepage that links to multiple pages? For example, could I have an icon on the homepage that was like audio description project, and within that app, like a create a folder. Mm-hmm. It's similar to creating a folder.
Yeah.
Where within that ADP
folder
icon, I could have like the link to the Netflix ADP and a link to the Amazon Prime. Can you do that?
Yeah. So, well, you would have to create a folder because yes, they're these bookmarks, but they are just literally like the similar icons to your apps and things. So like they can be moved around. So, you would want to create, so like I would say in that case, you would want to, you would add them each individually as these shortcuts on your homepage. And then you would just, move them like into a folder and then add additional icons to the folder like you would with any app. So maybe it's easier to set them all up individually page by page, and then they would be on your home screen there. Like, so each of them is going to point to one website, and then you can, you know, create the folder, right? Like, so you would go to edit mode and then add one to the drag session. And then on your second one, you would activate that action of creating a folder with these two apps, right? And then you would create the folder, and then you'd go back out with the scrub gesture, find your other apps, create a drag session with them, and then, you know, go back to your folder and select, you know, drop them into this folder. You know what I mean? So like one icon cannot point to multiple pages, but you can definitely, you know, manually create the folder and put the different icons, different shortcuts, you know, in there the same way you would with moving an app into a folder.
Yeah, this is Greg.
Yep. Yeah, go ahead.
I've been setting up, I've just recently started setting up folders in Safari where, like one for menus of, you know, places that we go, instead of doing a separate search every time, I'll just have that link in under menus. But this would even be a quicker way to have it on where I don't have to open Safari. I can
exactly
go directly to that link or to that icon.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And I know, like, I was thinking, and I forgot to mention this, like, yeah, I'm sure you could set up with like the Shortcuts app and Siri, but like, especially if you're in a noisy place or just you don't want to talk to Siri. And I mean, yes, you could set up the typing with, but like, this is just way quicker. You're not even interacting with Siri and, you know, worrying about that. You're just, it's just a couple of taps away. Yeah.
This is Sri.
Go ahead, Sri.
So when you create this bookmark, excuse me, will it also create the bookmark in the Safari also?
I don't believe so. I have not checked that. I would have to look, but I do not believe that it does, because that is a separate option in that share sheet to add to the bookmarks in Safari or to the favorites bar. So no, I don't believe so. I believe it is just, I would have to, I'll have to check and confirm that. But I do think it is just this one shortcut, but for some reason it's like when you go to delete it, it's performing the same function. It's just in a different, I don't believe it's in that Safari folder. Instead, it's on your home screen.
Okay, thank you.
Yep.
This is D.
Go ahead, D.
Yeah, I was gonna say for Greg, I made a folder. Y'all gonna laugh now. It's called Obituary. And in there, I went to four different pages, four different funeral homes, and attached them into the obituary thing, the way that, you know, you did with that shortcut to the homepage. And it works great.
Oh, well, there you go.
I can go in there every day and see if I'm alive or which ones of my friends have died. And within a 25-mile area. Oh.
Well, we hope they're all still with us. And thank you for that. So there you go. Yeah, it's literally just what Dee described. So there, you would just be doing it with audio description providers and stuff.
Yeah, this is Kathy.
Thank you for let's see. I heard someone before.
Greg and Kathy, I think.
Oh, is it Greg and Kathy? Okay, go ahead, Greg. No, it wasn't.
I said yes. Adam.
Oh, Adam, yes, go ahead. Hi.
I'm sorry. I'm just curious. If a sighted person was using my phone, you said the name of the app on the homepage by default was My App.
Yes.
What would be the default icon if a sighted person was using my phone?
Right, right. I think it would actually just be My App. I don't actually know what the associated image would be. That's a good question. I think the text would definitely be written there somewhere, because it was a text field where it said MY space APP. So presumably, like, it actually shows, you know, those words. So I don't know if there's some kind of an image to accompany that. There very well could be, but that's a good question to, like, ask an IRA agent or something and get back with you on.
This is Sri.
Go ahead, Sri.
I think it's going to look like a web page, kind of default web page, kind of a look of, like, okay, you're opening it. This is my guess, because it is really a bookmark link, right? So it's probably
right. And that's how a bookmark link is going to look.
Look, yeah.
Look, you're saying. Yeah. Okay. That seems to me to make sense. But I guess, you know, we don't know until we know, but that seems like a really good guess.
This is Sandhya.
Go ahead, Sandhya.
We need to go back to Kathy.
Yes, thank you. Go ahead, Kathy.
I was wondering if you could use this for getting on the iBUG call. For what I do is I have iBUG Zoom stuff saved in a contact. And usually I go to contacts and then I search for Friday.
Mm-hmm.
And go to the contact Friday night movie, and then I go to the homepage, and then it goes to Zoom. But right. could I put all that on my homepage and just call it iBUG or call it?
Oh, you mean like the? You mean like that Zoom URL, right? The zoom.us/j/ with the ID and the password and such.
Yeah, could I put that in my, when I'm in my contact, can I do the share thing and then just have it on my home screen? So instead of
From your contact, you're trying to do that. I see.
Yeah, is that a whole different thing, or would that
Right. I don't know off the top of my head if in the contact share sheet, I don't think I have seen, I very well may have missed because I haven't gone into that share sheet with a contact or the URL in a long time. Go ahead, Brad.
She's talking about putting the URL in your Safari browser and then executing the page. And like on most Zoom pages, you're then prompted if you want to let it open in Zoom,
open the app,
or cancel. Yeah. And if you say cancel, it just sits there. And yep. Now you can do what Maria's talking about.
Exactly. Into, yeah.
Yeah. And that'll right.
Yeah. No, thank you for that. Yeah. So I was going to recommend not doing it from the contacts app, but I didn't know if it was, you know, possible perhaps okay. since you've already set that up. But yeah, doing this will, what Brad was just saying, because that will allow you to do it from Safari, and then that would absolutely work. So essentially, so it's going onto the iBUG Today website and finding that those connection instructions, right? And then you're going to select, right? You're going to click on that URL, the zoom.us02.zoom.us/j/ so on and so forth. And then once and then it's going to prompt you, like Brad said, to open in Zoom, and you have the open or the cancel, and you'll pick the cancel. And so then you will be on that Zoom page where you can, you can click, you know, open the app or what have you, but you don't want to do that. You want to then go to the share sheet and add to homepage. Okay. Yes, exactly.
Oh, okay.
All right.
Okay, thank you.
Very good.
This is Dan.
Go ahead, Dan.
Yeah. After a person types in the new name for your bookmark,
yep.
you then have to hit the add button to make it go to the home screen?
Yes. Yeah, exactly. Because if you don't, it's just going to sit there on that screen with the edit field still being active. So you have to, you know, tell it that you're done typing the name. Once you click that add button, double tap, you should be taken to the home screen then with your icon there. And I did, to answer Shree's question, I did just go through my bookmarks and I do not see this page that I added in my bookmarks as well. So it looks like that what I said was correct, that it does not also add it to Safari bookmarks.
Thank you.
Okay. And this is Dan again.
Yep. Go ahead, Dan.
Okay, so I'm a little bit confused about how you actually delete the we'll call it a bookmark your home screen.
Sure.
Go through that again.
Sure. So what you're going to do is, so it's like deleting any other app, essentially. So what you're going to do is you're going to go into here. Let me turn my speech on. Okay, so I had it off while I was checking the bookmarks. Okay, so you're gonna so we're here on this
route 13 schedule.
Yeah, so this is our bookmark here on our home screen. So we're gonna flick down, so our actions rotor should be in focus, that, you know, actions are available on the home screen, the icons, so we're able to flick up and down. So we're gonna flick down to edit mode.
Started editing.
We double tapped. Now we can go to either, usually you'd go to delete. So for consistency, we can do that. I'm saying if you just double tapped here, the default action on this icon here is to delete. So you can either just double tap to activate the activate action. But if you want to be sure, we're going to flip down.
Delete.
To delete, double tap.
Alert. Delete bookmark.
And you see here, this is the confirmation. It's not saying delete the app or anything. It's saying delete a bookmark. That's what I was doing to demonstrate to you all that it is a bookmark, just in a different location. So now on the screen, it's a confirmation screen. So if we flick to the right.
Are you sure you want to delete the bookmark? Cancel, not delete.
And so I'm just flicking to the right. And so then, yes, if I hit delete here, if I double tapped.
Actions available.
I love
finished editing batteries.
Aha, uh-huh, you see now my batteries widget. So that this is now it's been moved to the left. So that route 13 schedule is no longer there. So it is gone.
Yeah, very good. Thank you.
Yep.
Wow. All right.
Well, all right.
Thank you, Maria. Very useful. Definitely encourage people to try that out. And have a bookmark for iBUG to get there quickly, right?
Indeed. that was a very good putting that in on top.
Okay.
I should have showed that, see, but I got caught up and this is my real life example.
Your real life. Okay. Thank you, Maria. Okay, so the who has a question that they, you know, either somebody who has not had a turn would like to ask a question, or somebody else who has another question. Either way, we have lots of people online. Yes,
this is Ned.
Ned, go ahead.
Yes. How does one copy a text message and then paste it? I'm in my text messages and I want to copy it, put it in another text box that I can forward it to send it to another person.
All right.
Who the gestures to copy and paste?
All right. Who would like to explain that to
this is
Ned?
Terry?
Yes. Go ahead, Terry.
What I do is if I'm in a message and whether if I have several messages in that message thread back and forth with a person or just one, I can flick up to more and double tap on more, and then I can flick to the right and it says either delete or forward. And if I'm going to forward it to somebody else, I'm going to double tap on the forward, and then it'll ask me, you know, who I want to forward it to and so on and so forth. And so you can send just a one part of a thread or every part of that thread that you select by going to more and just double tapping on it. And then it says selected, whatever of those items that you've selected, you can then forward to this other person.
Right.
Brad.
Thank you. Okay. Brad. Okay. Yeah. Go ahead, Brad.
I'm going to do Terry one better. If you're in a text message thread and there's just one item, one bubble you want to copy, you can, with your rotor set to actions and your focus on one of the items, you should be able to flick either up or down. It doesn't matter. And one of the items in the actions menu will be copy. And you just double tap and you have just copied that item to your clipboard. And then you can go to another conversation or create a new message or whatever. And then you go to the edit field. And then once you've activated the edit field, want to turn your rotor to edit and then flick up or down until you get to paste and double tap. And you have just pasted what you just copied into the text edit field.
Right. And so just to clarify, so those are two ways to do. So Ned's original question, I think, was to copy copy a text message. So, you know, if you are going to send it to somebody else, then you would use Terry Ann's way and you don't have to copy it. You can just forward it. But if you want to use that, the substance of that message somewhere else, put it in an email or whatever, save it forever, then you would use Brad's method. So I hope
this is true.
Okay, hang on. Ned was going to say something. Ned?
Yeah, this is Ned. So I want, it's one bubble. I just want to do one bubble that I want to forward at this point. So I would do just swipe up to the more, right? I would touch that bubble.
Yeah.
And then it talks to me. So I know I'm in that bubble. And then I just swipe up.
Swipe up to more. And then at the bottom, it'll say forward or delete. So don't hit the delete, hit forward. And then you'll be prompted for the to field. You have to tell it who you want to forward it to.
And then that's when I touch the new. Okay.
Okay.
This is Tree.
Brad was first, then Tree. Yeah, Brad.
To do what I did by going to the actions menu and copying the bubble, you can forward that too. You can, like Tanya said, you can do whatever you want to with it.
Right, right.
You could paste it anywhere. But yes, you then leave the conversation you're in now, go to another conversation, one that either exists or one that you create as a new conversation, and then you paste it in the message edit field, and then it's in there too. So it's the same thing as what Terry's saying to do. It's just a different way to skin the same cat.
Okay, thank you. I'll try both ways.
All right, Tree.
I'm going to give her an option that's worse than Terry and Brad.
Oh, great.
What you can do is just do a one finger triple tap on the message, swipe right to copy,
and then do what Brad said. You can go to edit and paste.
All right. And just to contribute one other thing, Ned, like unlike emails, when you forward a text message, the recipient, you know, who you're forwarding this to has no clue whether you're sending. I mean, it just looks like you sent it. So there's no indication this was forwarded from Sandhya or anything like that. So just sometimes I will, you know, if I'm sending something that somebody else sent me, I'll say, this is a message I received from Joe or whatever. So, all right. Okay. I think I heard, so that's that. Thank you, Ned, for that great question. Mr. McCulloch, I think I heard you earlier. Was that you?
Yes, I have a question about Zoom.
Good.
I don't know if anybody uses Zoom on the video, turning on your video, sharing your video. If you're some meetings I go to require that. And just in the last few weeks, I've noticed if I like, you know, put my hand up near my face, like if I'm scratching my ear or picking my nose or something, and really? I hear voiceover say, you're about to raise your hand. I don't know if anybody has noticed that or anybody ever used sharing your video.
So this is Sandhya. Are you saying now that you don't have to even literally push the button? You can just raise your hand and it's watching you?
Well, it's watching. Obviously, it's watching me.
This is Terry.
Sees me, but it's not using the raise hand feature. It's not, you know, it's not enabling that. It's just a message to me.
Well, this is Sandhya. I'm coming to you, Terry, one second. I've been on Zoom meetings where we have the cameras on, and it will, I think I've mentioned this, it will describe to me like lady with glasses. So as people are speaking, it's, you know, it's telling me like window, whatever. So like it's describing who it's seeing in that window. So, all right, Terry Ann.
I read somewhere recently that Apple was going to that, so that your camera or something will see your hand and you're not even touching the phone, but you're creating a gesture that it recognizes executes that gesture. I read that was coming forth, but I didn't know just when, and it sounds like it might be something along those lines now, because right. They want to go to more hands-free kind of stuff.
Right. Thank you, Terry and Tree.
So Michael, my question is, was this doing it when the focus was on you, or were you just raising your hand when somebody else was talking?
Michael, yeah, it's someone else is speaking, and I'm just, you know, sitting there in the background, I thought, not being observed or anything. And then, like I said, I scratched my head, and it thinks I'm raising my hand. It says, you're about to raise your hand.
So I just turned my video on, and I'm talking to you, and I'm raising my hand, and I hear nothing.
Okay. Are you on what are you using? This was on my Mac, so.
I'm using my iPad.
No, it was on my iPad. Take that back when I noticed it. I've heard it describe things like Sandhya said, when, you know, describes the speaker, but this is the first time I've ever heard it describe, you know, giving a description of any gestures I'm doing. I'm just curious if I give it the middle finger, what'll it do?
Mr. McCulloch. Okay, what? Moving on.
This is Maria.
Go ahead, Maria.
Super quick. It's okay.
I haven't, I tend not to use like Zoom as much on my like phone as my computer. But what I will say is that a lot of video meetings that I'm on, I've noticed that it seems to be like a mix of whether certain people use the raise hand feature and others just actually raise their hands, and then the presenters see them raise their hands. So you know, it's like very possible that, you know, that Apple or Zoom even is just like looking to kind of capitalize on that trend, because people, like you said, it's the hands free, like someone actually, which for us, right, it's a little tricky because we're not gonna know, you know. So but it is something that sighted folks, I've kind of noticed that sometimes when I've used raise hand and I've been the only one, and then I'm like, oh, I guess I just need to physically raise my hand. So just to be aware of that.
Right, well, any other comments on this? We'll move on. Thank you, Mr. McCulloch.
Mr. Greg.
Greg.
Yeah, Michael, it may start telling you to stop picking your nose.
I know, right? And scratching your head. Okay. Thank you, Greg. Manners. Okay. Who's next? Something new, somebody new, new issue?
It's Roy.
Roy, go ahead.
I have a tip for anybody that wants to listen to the Super Bowl via the radio.
Yes.
I found it in the iTunes app, but it actually works with Siri, because it's an ESPN station, it's regional anyway for Texas. You can just say play WLXG if you want to hear the game Sunday, and it'll play it. Just ask Siri to play WLXG.
WLXG.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
All right. Thank you, Roy. Can't wait. Thank you, Roy. Okay, so now y'all are ready for the Super Bowl. Okay. Who's next? Anybody else? New question?
It's Kathy.
Kathy.
I have a question.
Yes.
So last week I went to get into DoorDash. And as it turns out, I guess I haven't ordered from there for like a year, because my credit card number was, you know, I'd updated it to the next, you know, to a new number. And when I was trying to put in the new number, so I had the kind of the form screen where you have to, I think there were like maybe four things, you know, you had to tell it what your, oh, I'm not going to remember what you call these things, but you know, your three digit code, you have to put that in, and you have to put your, but every time I'd come to the credit card number, it wouldn't let me put in like 16 numbers. It would get to, put them all in, and it would get to like the third from the last, and then it would just stop. And I couldn't, I mean, I went around a couple of times, Paul, you know, got Paul to do it a couple of times. I couldn't figure out, there was just seemed like no way to get those extra numbers in. And I don't know if it was because the card was similar but not the same, or I don't know, but I could never update it. And like with these places, you can't call anybody. There's no.
Right.
You know, so it's like my life with DoorDash is over, because I can't.
No. Okay. Hold on. And maybe Maria will say. Hold on, Kathy. Go, Maria.
Okay. So I don't have this, you know, I haven't experienced it with this field yet, but what I will say, I would definitely have the like DoorDash website up in your bookmarks as a secondary, because the app has lately, it does this. I'm kind of not surprised to hear this, because it's been doing weird things in terms of like scrolling, where like sometimes if you go to flick to the left a couple of times to scroll backwards, it'll take you to the beginning. So you have to do a lot of scrolling with the three finger flick up and down and exploring by touch. And then when you go into like a menu, it does this weird thing, especially like if you expand menu categories, where it'll like repeat prior menu items before it tells you the next one. It's really weird. And so like, again, you do a lot of like flicking and exploring by touch, and scrolling and exploring by touch. Yeah. And so I would definitely try it like on the DoorDash website itself, whether in Safari, you know, or iOS or wherever, or what other platform, because I have honestly a feeling that that will at the moment work a little better for you, and then just use like the app to track your order.
So. Well, I think I am using the app. I mean,
I'm saying to like try using the website, like DoorDash.com, to update your info and even maybe place the order and then use the app to like just track your order, because you might have less of this like scrolling and repeating nonsense in the website.
So you mean go into Safari? You don't even mean on the computer. You just mean on my phone, go to Safari, go to DoorDash.com.
I think you should be able to. Yeah, because I can't imagine why it wouldn't work. I mean, it might offer you to like open the app, but you don't need to, you know, you can just cancel that out and then stay on the website. I would think so. I can't try it right now because of the lovely Braille display lockup issue. And I don't want to have speech going while I try and tell you all, but yeah. So
and the irony is, I mean, DoorDash keeps sending me these, you know, 50% off, you know, your next three orders.
Mm-hmm.
I cannot you know, I cannot use it.
Sure.
All right. Well, good luck, Kathy.
I think David had
it. I heard David.
Go, David. Oh, there's another little tip. I mean, this is just generally for these apps. What I do is I've set up my Apple Pay on the phone, and I've also have a PayPal account. So a lot of times you can just use one of those two payment methods. Oh. And so you don't have to worry about updating your credit card in every single app that you might barely ever use and so on. So that might be a little pro tip there. I don't know.
Pro tip? I was waiting for it. Pro tip. Okay, David.
I have a question. Is Apple Pay got your Apple card, or does Apple Pay just mean the way you pay for your apps? Like,
it's just a way to register your credit card or debit card. You can use the, of course, if you're at a store, you like tap it on their little device and you use your passcode or your face ID or whatever. But if you're doing it on an app, you'll be asked to do your passcode or face ID to confirm. Or you just double tap the side button, you know, and then it'll confirm that you really wanted to do that.
Okay. Yeah.
So yeah, it's not directly associated with the Apple card, but but you could put your Apple card on Apple Pay, I suppose.
Right, but it's not the same. I don't have an Apple.
Right, it'll use any Visa or any MasterCard, American Express, Discover.
This is Maria.
Maria.
Just to follow up, so while I was muted, I went into Safari since I'm speech only at the moment. You have to, when you go to DoorDash.com, it'll prompt you, like, do you want to download the app? And you have to click continue in browser. But then, and I didn't because I only just did it, but I then saw just the page and it said, like, sign in, sign up, and favorites near you and all of that. So hopefully if you sign in from there, you should. And I think, you know, the Apple Pay thing might solve your issue with the card, but you still might have a headache when it comes to, you know, browsing the menu and things like that in the apps. That's what I'm just saying for now.
At least,
you might want to try with the website.
Oh, okay. Oh,
and here good I luck. Thought it was hopeless.
Oh, I see. Nothing's hopeless. Nothing's hopeless. Good luck. Good luck, Kathy. She can go back to DoorDash. Okay, with that pro tip.
We'll eat again.
You will eat again. Yes. All right. Very good question. All right. Who's next? Anybody else?
Linda.
Who? Linda?
Yes. Another Apple question. I had set up Apple recently with a new credit card, and I went to give somebody some money, and I went through the text portion of it and went down to the Apple Pay. And when I tried to pay them, it said something about this was fraudulent. And I was scared to continue, so I didn't.
Well, we could try it out. You can send me some money. I mean, so it didn't go through, was what you're saying. You were trying to send it to a friend, and then.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Anybody had that issue or any thoughts for Linda? That's interesting. So it said, this is fraudulent.
I guess I'll just have to try it with somebody else and maybe send them a dollar. No, I've sent it to you before, Sandhya.
Yeah, no, we've tried it before. Yeah, so.
Yeah, but this is a different card, so I was scared to continue, but I guess I'll try it again.
I can send your dollar back, so, yeah. Okay.
You're talking about Apple Cash? I missed the beginning of that.
Apple Pay.
Yeah, somebody on the other end has to have it enabled. And if they haven't had enabled Apple Pay on their end, they can't receive anything from you because they haven't turned it on.
Okay, maybe that's it then. Okay.
Yeah, that's it.
All right.
And then they got to accept it. I sent one to my wife. She never turned it on. She never accepted it. And it just sat there and eventually it went away because I was trying it out. And I figured, well, that's a safe place to send a dollar. Yeah. Well.
Yeah.
You sent her a whole dollar, huh, Brad?
A whole dollar. Yes, wow. I did. You're... She wouldn't accept it.
Well, so wait, wouldn't she get a prompt that you were trying to send her money?
She did. She ignored it.
Okay. Well.
So, I mean, the person on the other end may have received a prompt or something. They just didn't do anything with it or, but they have to turn Apple, they have to turn on Apple Cash or whatever it's called on to use it.
Okay.
This is free.
Free.
So, but Brad, she didn't get a fraudulent alert or anything, right? She just didn't accept it.
No, she said, oh, it's from him. I don't want anything from him. No, she just didn't want to fool with Apple Cash. She's like, I don't want to fool with that. So she ignored it.
Yeah. I think she got a fraudulent alert.
And I figured I could send it to her, a dollar to her, and it'd end up right back in the bank account that it came out of. But
wait. We're not answering her question. Why did it say fraudulent?
I don't know. I have no idea why. That makes sense. Unless the person on the other end flagged it. I don't know. It's weird. Yeah.
Okay.
This is Terry.
Go ahead, Terry.
You might, if because it said that, you might have to check with Apple about that.
Good evening, everybody.
Because they could certainly tell you, you know, what's going on there. If that were me, I'd be kind of scared too. And that's the next thing I would do.
Okay. Okay, Linda, that's a possibility. All right. Thank you, Terry. So good luck, Linda. You can send me a dollar.
This is Sri.
Sri.
So I have another question. This is about going into Safari with a Bluetooth keyboard. Okay. Is there a keyboard command to go to the URL like you can do on a computer? Is there a keyboard command for that for the iPhone? I don't know.
All right. Would somebody like to answer that using a Bluetooth keyboard? Go ahead, Brad.
Did you try command L?
I did.
It didn't. Did it do it?
It didn't take me there.
Interesting. Try containers. Maybe it's treated as a container.
Okay.
It's been a long time since I've used a Bluetooth keyboard with either of my iOS devices.
Greg.
Yeah, what about, on a PC, I'd do Alt and the letter D, maybe Command D.
I could try all 26 letters and eventually try.
Well, I mean, Command L is like related to the Mac command, I think. Is what
Control L.
No. Stop while we're ahead. Okay. So Command L didn't work. So
I don't think it worked. I that was the first one I tried with Command L.
Okay. Figured out. Tell us what happens next time. Okay. To be continued. All right. Last 1 minute question. Anybody? No?
Kelsey.
I have a LinkedIn question that has been bothering me for quite some time now.
Okay, hurry, go.
The question is, when you're using groups within LinkedIn and you're trying to make a comment, I've noticed that the text field is not voiceover friendly. So you double tap on it to try and type and it just won't, it's acting like there's no text field there.
All right. So anybody use LinkedIn with voiceover? Okay.
I've used it, but I haven't commented in a group in a while, but it's very possible. I would definitely, I'll have to try that and see if I experience it. But if you're like consistently reproducing it, I would definitely do like an app feedback thing and like report that over to them.
Okay.
All right, way to go, Kelsey. We got it right under the wire. Yes, who's that? Tree?
It wasn't me.
Oh, somebody. Okay. All right. Keep blaming tree. Okay. So
I'm in the waiting room.
Yeah. Go ahead. All right. So with that, Maria, thank you for helping me facilitate tonight. It's pretty busy. And we want to remind everybody real quick of upcoming events. Tomorrow's Clubhouse iBUG Mini Buzz from 5 to 6 Central Time. Thursday, the book club. Start reading Sapiens, A Brief History of Mankind. And the book is not brief. It's about 17 hours. But I know you can finish. It's $81,335. Go get it on Bard and start now. Then the movie is His Girl Friday for Friday. How cool is that? iBUG Night at the Virtual Movies. And the movie, I believe the year is 1940. So it's a classic, all right? So it's going to be really cute. It's a romantic comedy, murder, and all kinds of good stuff. So that's Friday. Then Saturday is the iBUG Cafe, and we're talking about voiceover settings. I stand corrected. So it's voiceover settings, lots of detailed information there. Come for that. And then that will end our week for this week. So we will see y'all soon. Come back next week. On Valentine's Day, romantic. We'll all be together.
Happy birthday, Maria.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you. All right, y'all.
Good night, everyone. Thank you.
Thanks for all your help and participation. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Stay well.
Happy birthday, Maria. Good job.